Reverend Bishop Long to arrive. We had a few techno difficulties, and we are waiting for this to all he should be able to enter. Oh, there he is. My good friend.
Matt, I figured out what it was, Donald. It's not want me to, it gives me the option of copying the link, but then Zoom won't take the link. I actually have to type in the number, and when I type in the number, it goes through.
Okay, so we got that fixed.
It's fixed. I know how to get in on all of them now.
Okay. Will you open us in prayer?
I would be more than happy to. Dearest Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have given us the opportunity to come together as brothers to fight for the sake of Christ, that you have given us the power through your Holy Spirit to trample the devil under our feet.
Man.
We know, dearest Heavenly Father, as the times are dark, we know that your light is greater. We know that the truths of your inerrant, infallible, and inspired word will overcome everything, that the gates of hell cannot overcome your true church.
Man.
We ask you, dearest Heavenly Father, to strengthen us for mission and ministry, and we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I'll be a Baptist and say amen and amen. Can I'm going to go to screen share if you're okay with that.
Go for it.
Okay, give me a second on that. Here we are. It should come up.
I just got off the phone with one of your contacts a little bit earlier, and I'm going to tell you that they're proud of the work you're doing.
Oh, really?
Yes, I got to hear all about it this morning.
What value do they see?
They see that basically you are correcting a problem that should have been handled long ago.
Okay. Are these Anglicans or Reformed people?
The contact wishes to leave their name out of the conversation.
Okay. Well, can you see the screen share?
I can see screen share. I can't hardly see you, and I can't see me anymore.
Well, we're little. It makes us to be little.
I see you up at the top. I ain't on there anymore, but it don't matter. I get tired of looking at myself anyway.
Yeah. Well, if you can see the screen share where it says YouTube with Bishop Presbyter Aaron Long and Veitch.
Got that.
Okay, well, we come down here to, this is Fenwick. This is
who is that Muslim he's with? And why are they dressed up like gays?
That's the dress of the Syrian Orthodox people.
They wear pink frilly dresses?
Yep. This is Fenwick, a student of Orthodoxy. Syrian Orthodox man, and then Fenwick's lapdog and anti-Calvinist Steve Paul Hunt, two bishops who had a Syrian Orthodox co-consecrator. So I put that up for information again. Aaron, this is going to go to maybe 500,000 people. 500,000.
Well, I don't mean to be racially insensitive or anything, but in all honesty, that ain't Anglicanism. And how can you say you're FEC? That ain't Protestantism. It ain't Anglicanism. It ain't even Papism.
No, it's Orthodoxy, Oriental Orthodoxy. There's Sutton. No, could be Sutton. He may shift over there too, but this is Fenwick with his Syrian Orthodox friends. So I wanted to
but
put
they
that
reject in. Augustine, and if you reject Augustine, how can you claim to be a Western Christian?
And he rejects the filioque clause that you might expect as well.
Right.
And has a trial Syrian Orthodox liturgy in effect. We need more info on that. But I just wanted to put the pictures up because there's 500,000, including John and Liz Fenwick, who listen. So I set an agenda. You opened us in prayer, but I wanted us to remember that there's, can you, I don't know if you can read it, but there's a hundreds of thousands are going to be exposed to what we're talking about. So it's not just you and me as two yappers and two friends, but it's a lot large audience.
Well, I'd actually like to focus a little bit on that last sentence you got under point two here for a second.
It's not just us two yappers.
No, it could be, could we have a revival of the Reformation again?
Yes.
All right. I'm going to tell you, Donald, I've been thinking about this all morning. I am ashamed, and I'm talking about ashamed of Western Christianity in general. It is a sad state of affairs when a bunch of dipsy-dunkered Baptists, I about said an ugly word, and a bunch of Mormons and a bunch of Jehovah's Witnesses who ain't nothing better than Satanists, and a bunch of Pentecostals practicing their magic, can ultimately do better evangelism than us who have the true gospel. This is what I am getting more and more fed up with over time. We sit around in our hidey holes and our holy huddles, and we want to play dress up and dance around when people are dying and going to hell all around us, and these satanic cults are dragging them faster than we can get them up. And God is going to judge the church one day. God's going to judge Fenwick and all of them, and he's going to judge us if we don't get off our tails and start fighting this battle. It's not about the clergy. It's about the laity. It's not about playing dress up. It's about feeding the people and sending them out. I got a sign that hangs over the door at the top of the ramp of the church that tells everybody that walks out of this building that they're now entering their mission field. If there's going to be a revival, it's going to take us standing up, equipping the laity, and sending them forward. Them wearing them little gay pink frilly dresses ain't doing nothing but sending thousands to hell, whether I agreed with their doctrine or not, because it means they're more concerned about what they look like than they are about progressing the gospel. Sorry, I get off my soapbox.
Well, we're going to get there anyways.
We've got the gospel. God has given us everything we need, and it's like we are too busy having to deal with these devils in our churches that are trying to corrupt everything. We got to get out and we got to start fighting this fight, and we've got to equip the laity. I just got done talking to somebody else this morning. When a church starts worrying more about its clergy than its laity, when it starts worrying more about its liturgy than its laity, it's going to die. That's what's happening in the mainline. That's what's happening in Anglicanism. They're worried about keeping their pure pond, and people are going to hell, and God is going to judge them for that one day. It's like they ain't scared of the good Lord.
Okay, well, that brings us down to number three here, which kind of brings up what we did last week in terms of doctrinal declension. And, you know, I got corrected by a brother, Roger DuBarry, corrected in a good way, because we're getting into the nitty-gritty and the details of the Fenwick situation, which we have to do as forensic theologians.
Amen.
But, and we must fight back, and we must be snipers on the lookout for wolves to drive them off from the sheep, drive off the wolves, the foxes, the bears, and so forth. But in getting into all the detail, even I, theologically trained, got my eye off the ball and had not brought up justification by faith alone. And he said, keep that central. And we went over that, and I said, you know, he's absolutely right. How could I forget to keep that gospel central, strong, mighty, and powerful? If I do that, what about the sheep? If I'm dead, doesn't the sheep pick up on that? So I had to rebuke myself, and that kind of governs where we're going today. But
now, Donald, I'm going to say this. Let me interrupt you for a second.
Okay.
You, sir, are special forces. You are going in and you're making the strategic strikes. The gospel's always got to be first and foremost. Amen. I agree with that 100%. That said, you are taking the hammer and breaking the demonic machine that's taking over the church. It's the gospel has got to be center for people like me and some of the other parish clergy. We've got to take that gospel out into our pews. We got to empower our people with that gospel, and we got to send them. We got to feed them through word and sacrament, and we got to send them out into the world. And when they get sideways, here's the other thing. The church has got to start disciplining people again. If we don't stand for something, there ain't no point in us being.
So,
sorry, my carillon's going
no,
on.
Say that all again.
Donald, there's some people like you that are forensic theologians. Amen. You have got to keep justification by faith as your central thing. But Donald, your special forces right now. You are the landing party. You are the beachhead. You got to go after those demonic strongholds that Fenwick and them have set up. The people that really need to be hearing this are the preachers in their parishes, the pastors sitting in their pulpits. They don't need to talk about five easy steps to a better marriage. They don't need to talk about anything that makes anybody comfortable. We need more preachers stomping on toes in the pews and getting the people worked up and stirred up. They're scared of losing parishioners. If a parishioner is going to walk out because they don't like I'm preaching the gospel, let them walk. They wasn't saved to start with. I'll pray for them. We'll send people out there to witness to them. If we catch people in our churches acting like the devil, we need to call them to the carpet and discipline them. And we need to disciple our people. We need to teach our people. We need to reinforce the creeds, the catechisms, and the confessions. And we got to get them into the Bible. Your daddy said the best thing in the world to you when he said you need to read 10 chapters of the Old Testament, 10 chapters of the New Testament, and go through that catechism every day. I'm going to tell you, you know, Martin Luther said that. If you ever read A Simple Way to Pray, Martin Luther told that barber he needs to stop fooling around with all this papist nonsense. He needs to meditate on the creed. He needs to meditate on the commandments. He needs to meditate on the Lord's Prayer. He needs to read his Psalter, and he needs to be fed that way so we can go out with the pure gospel and win souls for Jesus Christ.
This goes back to what we said up here. I'm going to make it a little bigger.
I don't care. You do what you want to. People don't like me anyway.
They do, actually. What was it you said? Could we have a revival and reformation in our own time? I think that's what we should be asking.
I think we're going to have one, but it's going to take the pastors getting off their lazy butts. It's going to have us kicking the time servers and the hired hands out on their tail ends, and it's going to take us standing up in our congregations and actually feeding our flock. We need to, any preacher that's going to stand up there and say something that's nice and soft and talk like he's got a little lisp and like he likes to have it in the poop chute. I'm saying he likes to play around with boys and all the rest of that. We need to run them sorry things out the church. We don't need little skinny boys up in the pulpit. We don't need weak, mealy-mouthed men in the pulpit. We need men with calluses on their hands, fire in their bellies, and they need to be out there empowering the congregation to do the work of Jesus Christ. And it has to be guided by the confessions and the catechisms. It has to be based on the inerrant word of God. And it has to go forward like a mighty army. We can't be nice no more. The time for being nice is done. The time for politeness is done. We are facing the devil on the battlefield. And we got to take the fight to him. Like Odell said when he built his church and they took every brick from busted liquor stills, that when they built Paul's church, they gave the devil a black eye. Well, now what the devil is doing is he's creeping back into our conservative churches with these weak little mealy-mouthed washerwomen that are calling themselves preachers that need to get their tails kicked, need to get into the gym, need to actually do real work, need to get dirt on their hands, and need to man up.
What was it they said you had?
What you mean? Oh, sorry. Defiance, something obsessive defiance disorder. Evidently, I got a bad attitude.
Obsessive defiance disorder.
I ain't got this obsessive defiance disorder. I actually believe what the words say in the book.
Yeah.
And the thing is they don't.
That's the nice psychiatric way to shut you up for opposing them as a catechism man. That's what that is. Well, anyways, justification by faith. We've got all these wonderful documents. For me, there's 15 of them. You've got several others in yours with Luther's small, large catechism, Marburg colloquy, a few others. These are the ones I kind of work with in this pan-reformed approach. And of course, for the Anglicans listening to this, the 39 articles.
Now, I'm going to tell you, that actually weakens the Anglicans. And as I say that, they've only got one confession. They're not forced to daily go back and address this stuff. They instead, and I'm a big fan of the prayer book, as long as it's a good one. I ain't got a lot of use for the 28, to be completely honest. Because the dumpster fire of the baptismal service is, and the fact they cut the word elect out every time it pops up.
Yeah.
But that 1662 is good, and it's good for formation. But just standing on the 39 articles and just standing on the prayer book, it holds the line, but it don't hold it hard enough. And you know none of them sorry things actually read the Book of Homilies. And the prayer book catechism is worth about as much as the dirt on the bottom of my shoe. I ain't saying it ain't right.
I got it.
The offices of instruction in the 28 are basically just a way for the bishops to blow their own heads up because they added on all that other garbage about the orders at the end of it. What they need to do is they need to get them a darn catechism. And I ain't talking about that devilry the ACNA put out to be a Christian that talks about seven sacraments and talks about all this charismatic rolling in the pews and speaking that babbling tongues mess and all that satanic witchcraft you see. I'm talking about they need to get a hold of the Westminster. I don't see why the Westminster shorter. For that matter, if they want to go higher church, take Luther's stuff, but get a catechism that actually catechizes somebody.
Well, this 1563 catechism here was taught at Oxford and Cambridge.
Amen, because the Heidelberg was the best out of the lot.
Yeah, I agree with you. It's personable and it's comforting practice.
Now it needs a confessional along with it because there are some holes, but a confessional fixed the holes. Because when it was written to be read with the Second Helvetic and the Augsburg Variata that covered all the holes in it.
So, back to the point of justification lost in the churches, the five solas. You know, in my Episcopal background, justification by, whoops, what did I do? Justification by faith has never been mentioned. And now
well,
today,
it's because they don't have Reformation Sunday in their thing. I preach on the five solas once a year, no matter what, because that's what I'm supposed to preach on Reformation Sunday.
Whoa, you have to do that?
Yes, it's the way we always did. It didn't matter whether you're high church, low church, mid church, no church, you preached on the solas on Reformation Sunday. And you sang Mighty Fortress Is Our God.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's a good start because a little bit later, I'm going to ask you to give some counsel to Brett Murphy and Emmanuel. And that could certainly be something that Emmanuel could do is preach the five solas and maybe preach four or five sermons on justification by faith alone.
Well, if now, you preach the solas, you're going to hit justification by faith alone.
Absolutely.
Sola fide, sola gratia. Sola Scriptura, Sola Christo, Christe, Sola de la Gloria.
Exactly. Now, in our time, the last 40, 50 years, Tom Wright, Sanders, and a few others have attacked justification by faith alone. It's another collateral attack on it. We'll get to that.
Wright is a straight-up Satanist, and no good Christian should ever be reading that devil worshiper because he allows those satanic women priestesses.
Yeah.
Shouldn't have them witches in the church.
Let's
and
go
you can't
on.
Claim to be a Christian and believe in women's ordination. It ain't a second order issue, no matter what them devils want to say. Because Paul says to Timothy and Titus, he's supposed to be the husband of one wife. Paul says to the Corinthians, women are to be silent within the church. What that means is if you're ordaining women, you're basically taking the Bible, hawking up a big loogie and spitting in the middle of it, which is the same as spitting in God's face, and you're going to burn in hell for believing in women's ordination because you're denying Christ in the action.
Okay. Yeah, it's... Well, going back to Orthodoxy, I sent an email to Reverend Bishop Presbyter
Paul Slish.
Yeah, and Paul was raised as a Russian Orthodox. He knows it inside and out. He was confirmed in it, and he utterly despaired of ever having eternal life because of their definition of theosis, basically another version of Romanistic works.
I'd argue it's a little bit harder and stronger than Romanistic works.
I agree with you.
You get into the filioque, you get into the philokalia and reading about all that stuff. Theosis is rough business.
Yeah, and I also interviewed Matthew Joyner.
I like Matt.
Yeah, I don't know where he's at these days. He's pulpit supply in an Orthodox Presbyterian church. But he was educated Greek Orthodox seminary and then served in an Orthodox church for several years. And he had some really telling stories, you know, about how they condemn the Protestants, the Reformed, the Lutherans, anything that was Protestant. So I'm hoping to do an interview with Paul Slish.
Yes, sir.
Coming up. So I say stay tuned. Because the reason is Fenwick allowed and was angry about Brett Murphy having an Orthodox man as a postulant, as an assistant minister in Brett's church. And Brett tried to counsel him, and then he talked it over quietly with his leaders in the church. And then Fenwick got his panties in a twist.
But see, Donald, that's the problem. And let me get this off my gullet real quick. Everybody wants to be silent. Everybody wants to be nice. Everybody wants to be polite. What has being quiet and polite and all that gotten us over these years? Oh, we don't want to offend anybody. Oh, you have to go. I'm going to tell you, trust the process is like somebody saying, go ahead and bend over and grab your ankles. Because when you hear somebody say, trust the process, that means they're getting ready to hoodoo you in the process. And going, I'm going to go through the proper channels. I'm going to go through this bureaucracy. No, when you see a devil, even if they are wearing a purple shirt and a pointed fish hat, Dagon worshiping fish hat, you need to call that devil out to his face. Boniface did. I go through a list of these people, even the papists recognized that when they saw a devil sitting on that throne, they called that devil out. Oh, you can't call somebody a devil. You have to have this generous orthodoxy bull mess. No. Do you think Jesus had a generous orthodoxy? When Jesus saw the devil, he told the devil to get out of people. And he confronted him with God's word. People have become too weak and effeminate. And they talk with this girly voice. It's like the number of testicles that exist amongst the modern clergy could be counted on one hand half the time. God didn't make men to be in bureaucracy. God made men to stand up and be men.
So we come back.
If Adam would have told Eve to not listen to the devil, we wouldn't be in the mess that we're in right now. We need people with balls. I shouldn't say that on your thing. I know everybody's hearing it, and I know I'm going to have offended somebody's precious little sensitive sensibilities. Maybe their sensibilities need to be offended.
I'm a hardcore Marine. So, well, now what this does, we talk about this. Fenwick's got, he was an ecumenical officer like Shifty Sutton. Now, we do need to know that he is an utter failure. His denomination is
Fenwick getting a
sinking.
fail, Donald, hold on. Fenwick getting a failure. And I'm going to tell you, Fenwick's worse than Sutton by a long shot.
I think so, too.
Sutton is a grasper. Fenwick was the Church of England plant sent to destroy the FEC. Fenwick has not failed at anything. Fenwick has actually accomplished the mission he was sent in, which is to defang, deball, and destroy the FEC. Because the FEC was getting ready to start taking strong evangelical congregations from the Church of England. But the Church of England would rather fool around with fudge packers and satanic witches and have ecumenical agreements and empty sanctuaries. So they sent Fenwick in there to actually work against God. Fenwick is going to burn. He's going to be judged by God for what he has done unless he repents. I believe he can be saved, but he has to come out, be honest. Confess the Satanism. It's like N.T. Wright. N.T. Wright's a Satanist. If he will confess his wickedness and he will turn to the Lord, God will save him. But until you realize you are a sinner, you don't see the need for a Savior. Until you realize you're sick, you don't go to a doctor.
This raises the stern, stiff language of St. Paul in the Galatians, book of Galatians, that they are accursed, they are
Anathema.
anathematized if they reject the gospel of justification by works, justification by faith alone, and try to do it by works. Paul is clear in that. So the words first and this applies to Rome, the
Oh,
Greeks.
they're completely gone now. With Frankenstein talking about universalism, they might as well just shut the doors and sell off the property.
Who's talking about universalism?
Frankenstein.
That is Jorge Bergoglio, Francis the First.
Right.
Now,
He
one of
ain't
my,
nothing but a communist anyway.
well, I said Fenwick largely failed, but you're saying no, he
I'm
had.
saying he succeeded at exactly what he set out to do. And he's a liar if he said he set out to do anything else. He was a Church of England plant sent to destroy the FEC.
I'm really working on some details on 2001 and 2003 and 4 that he timed his arrival, and he was working in the background to get this ecumenical drive going. That's in the picture as well.
Well, I mean, you want to compare Fenwick to somebody, compare him to riches. And I'm not trying to defend Sutton. Sutton is a consequence, not a cause. Riches was trying to get in bed with the TEC, he was trying to get in bed with the APA, he was trying to get in bed with the ACC, he was trying to get in bed with the UECNA when it was under that Satanist reaver. He was trying to get in bed with all these people. And he's the one that was the mole that destroyed everything. People sit there and throw this fit about Sutton, and I'm not defending the man as I say this. Had Riches not done what he did, Sutton couldn't be where he is. Does that make any sense?
Makes sense. Now, here's what
And
we
he,
got to be. Got to be
wolf
wolf
hunters.
hunters. There's three of them taken down. Now, let me introduce you to Arthur Bentley Taylor. He was an FCE primus, I believe.
Oh, I ordered that book yesterday.
Oh, did you? Well, it's online.
Well, I went ahead and ordered it.
You ordered Dare to Contend.
Yep.
And then Cambridge and the Evangelical Succession. This is online. And what Bentley Taylor does is talk about where they were at in 2004. And this is a quote from him. Michael Root claims that by means of ecumenical theology, which is where Fenwick was, churches can come to agree on matters which in the past led to disagreements, so basic division was judged to be necessary. And cites a good example, the ecumenical just discussions of justification by faith. This Michael Root goes on, careful historical study has shown that mutual misunderstanding was rife in the Reformation period. Each side was rejecting positions the other side did not in fact hold.
Evidently, those people don't actually read history, because if you study, I'm a big fan of Lombard sentences, and I'm actually pretty well read in Aquinas, and I've done a lot of work in the medieval period. There's some straight up lies in that, because ultimately, until Luther brought up the issue of justification really wasn't talked about. When they go into this whole issue with the indulgences, all you have to do is go back to the 95 Theses. Luther is basically having to create a concept of soteriology, because the indulgences are just a big scam that's being run in order to basically pay for it. The doctrine of purgatory. Rome didn't define its soteriology until the Council of Trent. What you had before that was everybody was pretty much allowed to believe what they wanted to, as long as the money kept coming into the coffers. And then Luther spoiled it by forcing everybody to actually believe the biblical gospel.
Anselm of Canterbury held the justification by faith alone.
Amen, and he did.
Well, anyways, going on, because I want to finish
Oh,
where
I'm sorry, I've run my
that's
mouth too
okay.
much.
This guy Root is saying that Rome and the reformers misunderstood each other, and even Alistair McGrath says this is perhaps a classic case of theological misunderstanding based upon a disputed meaning of a theological term.
Well, I don't think they misunderstood each
I
other.
don't either. I don't. Let me get to that.
Okay, sorry.
Michael Root concludes the differences that distinguishes the two traditions need not continue to keep the Catholic from the Lutheran churches. That's Arthur Bentley Taylor talking of the FCE, their primus. And Arthur Bentley Taylor goes in the direction you were going to go. And he says the claim that the separation of Protestants from Rome was due to misunderstanding underestimates the scholarship of those involved in the 16th century. Buchanan, he's an old school Scots Westminster man, says the controversy between, and he wrote an excellent book on justification by faith, so that members of Emmanuel or presbyters in the FCE should digest that in the recovery of the Reformation's doctrine of justification by faith alone. Buchanan, the controversy between Rome and the Reformation was carried on with much keenness and with great ability on both sides. At the time, considerable efforts were made to find a compromise. These efforts culminated in agreement at the Diet of Ratisbon. Subsequently, the agreement was not acceptable to either side.
Well,
Far from
I hate to say it's insulting to people like Robert Bellarmine. I may not think he's a Christian, but he was one of the smartest men in shoe leather at that point in time. He understood exactly what he was writing on, not just the reformers, but on the other side.
Roberto Bellarmino, you're referring to?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he understood it Very thoroughly. And I have in a section up, my notes are now up to 382, the whole section on the Council of Trent. Well, anyways, Arthur Bentley will go on and say that rather than misunderstanding the subject, they really did understand it thoroughly, keenly.
Yeah.
So this goes on about the FCE and REC losing the gospel. And here's where I think Riches really lost it as a compromiser, as a professor of history, willing to join with Anglo-Catholics who deny the doctrine of justification by faith. With soon as you introduce missals and praying to saints that their merits would help in salvation, you have denied the totality and definite nature of justification. So Riches was a false teacher willing to sell out. And I hope Riches hears this. A lot more could be said about Riches. But here's Bentley Taylor in 2004 at a convocation in 2003, I should say. He offered an analysis of the things that were pulling the FCE apart. And he says there's those that want, it's not a power struggle, it's not incompatible personalities, it's a vision of the FCE as a broad, inclusive church.
Oh, you don't ever trust anything that's got that word inclusive in it.
Well,
the gospel is exclusive because there's only two religions in this world, and it's solid biblical Christianity or the mystery of the Whore of Babylon. And those are the only two choices you got. And there can be no fellowship between Christ and mammon. And well, mammon don't mean money. Mammon means the world system.
Well, this is a significant date, 2003, because Arthur Bentley Taylor sees what's going on with this broad inclusive approach, which is John Fenwick's.
Yeah.
There has been a decade of trying to finagle around on bringing the FCE to accept the three order system of government when they never did. And finally, Bishop Powell was willing to reduce doctrinal content down to the Trinity and downplay the rest of their articles. I have a witness to that statement. Arthur Bentley Taylor, on the other hand, as you can see in the yellow there, wanted FCE to stick to its guns, that it was reformed and evangelical in the sola scriptura sense. So you've got Fenwick over here wanting to hobnob with the Anglo-Catholics and the Orthodox. That's why I put the pictures up there, the false gospel of the Orthodox, denying justification by faith. That's Fenwick's baby. And he wants to corrupt the FCE instead of the FCE remaining reformed and evangelical, and I would say confessional. So that's the big contrast. Now, Fenwick himself has said he hates Reformed theology because it's unattractive.
Why would you be an Anglican and hate Reformed theology? Anglicanism is in the broader Reformed family. You can't not be some form of Reformed and accept the prayer book, much less the articles.
He told a confidant that he was going to drive Reformed theology out of the FCE. Now, my words to Emmanuel and Brett, re-elevate Reformed theology in your congregation. Teach your people the five solas. Teach them the 5 points of Calvinism. Just do it. The people, the sheep will hear God's word.
Right.
This was Fenwick's word, and he wanted, one of the other things he criticized the FCE was for its isolated, they were isolated and marginalized because they weren't broad and ecumenical.
Well, it's because he was a plant. It's why I don't like it when you call him a failure. He's not a failure at all. He's incredibly successful at what he set out to do. He's destroying the FEC.
I'm going to come down here, if we get through in time, to ask you your thoughts on what an FCE layperson and an FCE
Go ahead, Don.
I'm anticipating where you're going. And I'll put this in Fenwick promise to drive out Reformed theology out of this historically Reformed church. And he recognizes they were Reformed and Calvinistic.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, little Bishop Paul Hunt's a lapdog. I'm not sure. I don't know if he's very educated theologically. And I'm finding out the FCE really had some uneducated men in the pulpit. Now, switching to my favorite subject, Sutton told a senior professor at Reformed Episcopal Seminary in Philadelphia to not teach Reformed theology. Or Shifty again, in another one of his famous statements, we've spent the last 200 years correcting the excesses of the Reformation. He's referring to the Neil Oxford movement and the recovery of Anglo-Catholicism, critiquing, criticizing, and dismissing the Reformation. That's Shifty Sutton in this country.
Mm-hmm.
This is not to mention his two endorsements of the Anglican office book, which makes him an antichrist against justification by faith. Because there's 250 pages of invoking saints, and many and most of them say, and by the merits of Saint Teresa, may we enjoy eternal felicity. No.
And Donald, you're absolutely right.
He's a heretic.
But you've got something on there that shows even more heresy. The fact that the REC is part of the ACNA,
yep,
means that they are complicit in charismania, women's ordination, and all the rest of the errors of the ACNA. The ACNA did not fix anything. All it did was reset the clock after the ordination of that queer bishop. And what's going to happen is 10 years down the road, they're going to have the queers in the pulpits again because they didn't go back to the Bible. They didn't toss out that devilly 1979 prayer book. They actually used it as the foundation of their 2019. They did not go back to Christianity. And he's complicit in all of it. He can deny it all day long. I've been praying Sutton would stand up in one of these ACNA meetings and say, either you defrock all these satanic witches you got, or me and the REC is going to walk. I can disagree with him on a lot of stuff. If he honestly believes what he says, he can't be in communion with those Satanists that ordain women. He can't be in communion with those witches that practice charismania.
Yeah, charismania is, and this brings in the music angle that we've talked about a little before, but this is where we're at. Two contrasting visions put out by Arthur Bentley Taylor, where Fenwick is going in one direction in 2003, and he is holding Arthur Bentley Taylor to the old FCE, which includes the losing of the gospel. Now they have a prayer book, so the prayer book helps to push that off.
Can I break in real quick, Donald?
Yeah.
What you were talking about, and I want you to follow me down this rabbit trail.
Okay.
The ecumenism you were talking about is the divine feminine. It is the whore of Babylon. And the reason why I say it, whether it is the Anglo-Catholicism with its smells and bells, or it is the charismania, or it is the contemporary worship, is based around experience, emotion, and relativism, nicety. Okay. All of them, they don't look the same, but they're honestly the same because they're based on you feeling something. Whether it is a high church, Anglo-Catholic, pseudo-papal mass, or it's a praise band up front saying the same anthem over 1,500 times while they got smoke machines and lights. It is this divine feminine concept of the emotional experience. It's not Christianity, no matter how much they want to dress it up, because Christianity is a religion of the Word. Jesus Christ is the Word. The Gospel of St. John, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. St. Timothy says, Paul says to St. Timothy, it's a masculine Christianity.
Let me back up. I was goofing around with some of the
Oh, I'm sorry.
What's your summary here? It's experience-based with charismania.
Anglo-Catholicism, charismania, contemporary worship is all feminine and antichrist. It is about this ecumenical spirit. We need to worry about being nice to one another. We don't need to worry about truth. The feminine doesn't worry about truth. It worries about relationship. So they will sacrifice truth on the altar of relationship. You yeah. see it in the very formation of the ACNA. Notice they don't say it's reformed. They say it's the three streams are evangelical, Anglo-Catholic, and charismatic. Because yeah. ultimately it is this effeminate non-Christianity that they're proposing. You see it in theosophical societies. You see it in Eastern religions. You see it in the mainline. You see it in the contemporary worship church. It's the same devil with a bunch of different masks. It's why they won't just straight out call out the demonic witches that they allow in their pulpits, because that's what they instinctively want. It's nicety over love. It is emotion and feeling over truth. Christianity, truth has to be central. Truth doesn't care, truth doesn't care how you feel. A real man will not sacrifice the truth for feeling. Jesus Christ, I believe, is fully God and fully man. And as fully God, he loves his creation. But he is not going to sacrifice the truth for feeling.
Okay, well, that's gone off into women's ordination, but I want to keep... And I agree with you.
Okay, I'm sorry. But no, it's not just women's ordination. It's the Anglo-Catholic angle. It's the ecumenical angle. It is this antichrist, divine feminine coming to the fore. Why would a straight man wear all that lace?
You know, back in the 19th century, that was the characterization of Anglo-Catholics as basically a...
effeminate.
Effeminate. I mean, that was one of the criticisms that recurred over and over again. And of course, John Henry Newman, I strongly believe, was a repressed homosexual.
I don't disagree with you. But it's the same thing in your contemporary worship services with these skinny jeans and flip-flops in the pulpit, or what they call the pulpit.
I'm just going to say crummy theology in the music, in the lyrics.
Yeah, well,
I would say that reduces confessional depths.
But see, now their response is going to be confessions and creeds divide. We want to be in relationship, and we want to interact with one another. Yeah. And it's why I'm saying it's all effeminacy.
Yeah, well, I think there's some strong women who would agree with you, who are still feminine and are strong and smart and intelligent.
Which is why I keep saying effeminate. It is a mockery of what God intended.
Yeah, well, I want to make sure we protect godly, strong women. I want strong women around. I'm not intimidating that. I want them showing leadership here, there, and elsewhere. I want them doing their duty as mothers and grandmothers, more blah, blah, blah. I want them to be strong believers and helpers with the husband of catechizing the kids. So we don't want to use the word effeminate to abuse women either, by no means.
No, I don't mean it. That's why I say effeminate, not feminine.
Okay. All right. Well, anyways, here's a picture for those who don't know him of Shifty Sutton right there. The guy who has auctioned off justification by faith alone. Now, if I asked him that, He would absolutely deny what I'm saying. He would call me a liar. Yet, when he was confronted by Foley Beach about that godless heretical missal, the Anglican Office book, he said, "Oh, I recommend a lot of books that I don't agree with." Wrong answer, Shifty.
Why would you recommend a book you don't agree with? That don't make any sense.
Or in the endorsement, why wouldn't you put that caveat in there? This is
Right.
heresy. This guy will say anything to climb the social ladder, and he was in the consideration for Archbishop of ACNA. That's fact. I have an inside source on that. He loves power. Anyways, enough
Ray
on.
likes his Dagon fish hat.
Now, here's what I wanted you to do, Aaron.
Okay.
This is a theory. You're gonna, let me see, I'm fiddling with this stupid. That isn't what I wanted, though. We're gonna
I ain't
push.
never been outside of the continental United States,
Well, you are now. We're gonna put you on an airplane and fly you to England, and you're gonna
right.
go through the nasty experience at Heathrow Airport. Then you're going to be transferred up to Emmanuel in Morecambe, up in the north.
Yep.
And Brett Murphy has resigned. This is all theory. And you are now the new pastor with your German Reformed and Heidelberg Catechism background and experience widely. You're now the pastor. Now, Fenwick would never allow it, but let's say you're the pastor. What do you say to them theologically and pastorally? What do you
Well,
tell them? What do you start doing?
I do the same thing I do every time I go into a UCC church. Number one, I start honestly preaching through the old lectionary on Sunday mornings. Because the old lectionary, whether it's the ENR or the 1662, if it's preached through rightly and expositionally, hits every one of the doctrines of grace. Number two, we come in there either on Sunday night or Wednesday night, and we go through the Heidelberg Catechism or the Evangelical.
Let me fiddle with my stupid colors here. There we go.
But you preach the lectionary expositionally on Sunday morning with a focus on the confessions. You set up either a Wednesday night or a
Preach the
Sunday night.
lectionary as per the FCE prayer book.
Right. You
Okay,
go in.
let me get this. You're in charge now. With a focus on the catechism, do you say?
With a focus on the confessions and the catechism and how it relates. Beakey put out a really good, I wish I'd have brought it with me, I'd have showed it to you. Beakey has got one with all the central reform confessions and catechisms divided up by subject, and it makes preaching them real easy.
Who is this?
Joel Beakey.
Oh, Joel Beakey.
It's got the Second Helvetic, the three forms of unity, and the three Westminster standards. But instead of having them written straight out, like it's got God the Father, and then it'll have all the different mentions of where they explain. Do you know what I'm saying? Or the
I don't
second
have.
commandment or the fourth commandment.
So it Brett's listening to this.
But I mean, I would be preaching the old lectionary expositionally on Sunday morning. And I mean preaching. I
What is
don't
Beat's
mean,
book called?
huh?
What is Beat's book called?
I can't remember the name of it. It's like Reformed Confessions. It's a big, awkward sized book. I'll bring it next Friday and I'll let you take a picture of it. Or I'll get you a
Next
picture.
Friday. Oh, okay.
I'll send you a link to it later. I can't remember the name of it. It's in my office at the parsonage. But
Okay.
I mean, and we toss out this dishwater preaching. You need fire in the pulpit.
Toss out.
If a sermon ain't going over 20, 30 minutes, you ain't actually preaching. I mean, really get into it. Dig into it and stomp on people's toes. Stop caring about what your parishioners feel. The doctor don't care when you got cancer. What does the doctor do? He gets in there and digs that thing out.
Okay,
that's Sunday morning. And then you go through the Heidelberg on Wednesday night, Sunday night, and you go through it year after year. You don't worry about the lectionary. You worry about that catechism with your people every week, week in and week out. Number three, you get you a copy of Baxter's Reformed Pastor.
You're going too fast for me, my typing. Sunday and Wednesday night, Heidelberg Catechism?
Yes.
I tell you, I'm a WCS, Westminster Shorter Catechism boy, but I love my Dutch Reformed friends and German Reformed and Hungarian.
The Dutch stole that from us. The Dutch didn't write nothing. The Belgians wrote the Confession, the Council wrote the Canons of Dordt, and the Germans wrote the Heidelberg. Dutch are just real good at stealing stuff.
Okay, what else would you tell Emmanuel?
Richard Baxter's Reformed Pastor. I cannot recommend that book enough. Every preacher should be required to read through that book every year. You should be visiting your people, work the parish. This ain't a job. It ain't 40 hours a week. It's 7 days a week, 365 a year. You need every month for your first year to contact every member of your congregation at least once a month. You need to be talking to them privately. You need to be visiting home. Give me that BS. I ain't got time. I got to spend 8 hours on a sermon. I had an old preacher tell me a long time ago, if you were doing your devotions the right way, you should be able to crack open the Bible and commence to really laying it on them in a sermon without doing any prep. If you're having to take 8 hours to do a sermon, you ain't reading enough in your free time.
Okay, well, there you are in Emmanuel, and that what you have just said is a boatload.
It's only three things. You preach on Sunday, you catechize on Sunday, you preach on Sunday morning, you catechize on Sunday and Wednesday night, and you visit.
Okay, so basic, solid pastoral work.
But, I mean, how many preachers actually do any of that anymore?
I haven't had a pastoral visit since the 1980s, now that I think about it.
You want me to come out there and visit you, Donald?
Oh, I had a nice chat with you here week before by phone, and then I was at your consecration. And
but I mean,
I'm the old military guy, and you're that German, they call him the guy with defiance disorder. So now you're also in the church, and Fenwick's lingering around. Do you go after Fenwick?
Absolutely. If he sticks his devilish head in the church, I call him out in front of the laity. He ain't got no business in my parish. They called me. They didn't call him. It ain't about the purple shirts. It's about the laity. What's he going to do? Come in here and whoop my butt and throw me out? I ain't as good as I once was, but I'm as good once as I ever was, and I ain't above punching a bishop.
Would you file counter charges?
I definitely would. I would if, yes. What is he going to do? Throw the whole congregation out? Because the thing is if the preacher's visiting the way he should, yep, they ain't going to put up with no bishop telling them they have to get rid of a preacher.
And that's exactly what happened at Emmanuel. That congregation has been made stronger by Fenwick, and they've stood together and they said, bye-bye, Fenwick, and they've had their conflicts. But I think somebody in that congregation, and it needs, would you make it public?
Yes. I ain't playing this hiding in the shadows game. It's like I said, trust the process is the words of a Satanist. If you're going to do something, you need to do it in public. Be a man. If I could say that to everybody, I would. Don't go stabbing people in the back. Men don't stab people in the back. Might as well be out there buggering somebody if you're going to sneak around in the background.
Now, say you're an FCE presbyter down south, because the northern diocese is going to collapse. You're an FCE presbyter or layperson. Let me put that in here. Because I know of a few FCEers watching this, and I know what your answer is going to be. I'll pipe it before you say it. Okay, I know. I don't even need to ask you.
You know what I'm going to say?
I know
You
what
call that devil out every way you possibly can. You don't give him a chance to rest. You don't give him a chance to think. You don't give him a chance to defend himself. When he opens his mouth, you shout that devil down and you drive that devil out and you run that devil out on a rail. Tar and feather him if you can.
That is what he does to people with whom he disagrees. He drives them out harshly and toughly. He doesn't play around. He uses the canons and constitution and secrecy
They
and
shouldn't be secrecy in
kinsmanship.
the church.
He is a sociopath who has no feelings for those men. 35 men he has driven out of the ministry. He's shut down the Northern Diocese. I thought it was a failure, but maybe it's a success, as you noticed. Now,
You're not going to ever convince me it's not a success. He got what he wanted.
which was to make sure that the FCE would not be a safe harbor for exiting Church of England evangelicals. You are right now, I'm counting, there's seven, and I'm one of the seven who strongly believe that Fenwick was a church plant.
Bob, I'd let look, I'd put $5 on the barrel, and I ain't a gambling man. Like I tell them all the time, cards ain't gambling, cards is skill. I got thrown out of a, when I was in college, I got thrown out of a casino up there in Cherokee because evidently they consider counting cards to be cheating. I told them, how is it to being the smartest man at the table cheat? They're too dumb to actually count the cards. That ain't cheating. It's just them being too dumb to hold on to their money.
I think if I were an FCE presbyter in the South, now in the North, they're all leaving. Fenwick's going to be up there with Firth, the holy boy who believes
Somebody needs
Solomon.
to take that old man out behind a woodshed and just beat him until their life makes sense.
He's a 38-year-old single man. Calvin Robinson called him a repressed homosexual. He came out for a day or two trying to defend. The term sodomite should be translated as holy boys.
Why ain't somebody beat the fire out of him yet?
Well, Deuteronomy, I think it's 23:7
Oh,
says.
I know what he's talking about, but you know, there used to be a way we handled these things. Are people that weak, mealy-mouthed now that they don't? Ain't Donald, when you were a teenager, how many fist fights did you get in and it was just accepted in the way things were?
No. In
Seriously?
elementary school, yes, but not in
Okay.
high school. I was from a, frankly, I'll say it, an upper middle class background and attended kind of more of on that side. And no, we didn't do it that way. But now back to the FCE presbyters in the South. If I were one down South, I would make sure that my properties were secure.
Oh, absolutely.
And I would work with legal counsel to make sure
And
that Fenwick could not s fly in, grab the property, and throw me out. I would make sure I would work with my elders or vestry, or whatever you want to call it. I'd work with my leadership in the church. I think they call it the parish council and the wardens, and make sure that we as a congregation were united to stand together for the Bible, for the gospel, for the FCE articles and Declaration of Principles. And if I had all of that together, including security on the property, I then would go after Fenwick.
hammer and tongs.
Now, here we are. We're sitting here, you and I. This will go to 500,000 people. And this is you, Aaron. And Fenwick is on the other side because he listens to this. What would you say to Fenwick? And
Well, I'd
the
say if he doesn't repent and accept Jesus Christ, he's going to spend eternity in hell. And from what he has said, he's shown and how he has acted, he has shown he hadn't even read the Bible. He makes a mockery of Christ and he's not saved. He is not a brother. He needs to be defrocked until he repents of his evil. He is a sinner and not a sinner under grace, a sinner under the control of Satan. And he's going to be at the left hand of Christ at the judgment day, and you know the tree by its fruit, and the fruit's rotten.
Yeah, that's a good point. The fruit is rotten, as Jonathan Brigado said. He holds the Oz. What did I put back up here? The Oz Book Guinness of Records for the most ministers ruined.
I don't even see how he can honestly look at himself in the face and put on his clerics and get up in a church when all he's doing is dragging other people to hell with him every time he does it.
One person with background in psychiatry said dissociation happens with sociopaths, that when they get on to the anything that comes up very discomforting, like you're talking about hell and divine wrath and judgment, the second coming, they do something happens, clicks in their mind, that they put up a barrier where they cannot feel or think. And it's a natural thing that happens.
You know what they
So
used to call that, Donald? They used to call it demon possession. Mine eyes have seen the coming of the glory of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored.
well, he's given up the gospel.
He's given up Christianity, period. He's
What?
mocking.
Going out to Orthodoxy, he's given up justification by faith alone. That makes him anathema and accursed. That's where I go. And as such, now, would he affirm justification by faith? He might. And then tomorrow, tell you about the Orthodox view of justification as by works and theosis. So I mean, we're talking about double talk.
Right.
And my concern as a presbyter, and yours as a presbyter, is the people in the pew
Absolutely.
protecting them. Because Charlie out there working at the car shop fixing cars, he doesn't have time to chase all this down. Or
No.
the medical doctor, he's busy studying and helping people medically. He can't be sitting around doing church history, exegesis, systematics. That's our job.
Right.
And to help the laity to see this stuff and to understand what we're talking about. That's our role, is to put the truth forward.
Well, I'm going to tell you, Donald, if people just get up, preachers will just start getting up and actually preaching with some fire in their belly and preaching the gospel will do 90% of the work. Problem is they're preaching from a point of, even faithful preachers are preaching from a point of effeminacy and fear. They're not preaching strong. They're worried about what people are going to think. If you're worried about what people think, you ain't got no business being in this job.
Frankly, I think R.C. Sproul was a good role model for all of us. He called out the error or heresy as he saw it. He did it intelligently, gently, but firmly. And he is my role model and my friend of, well, he's over, well, 45 years until he died. He was my real bishop, and I used to joke with him about it. Well, we come now to Anglo-Catholics and justification by faith alone. And we've already indicated that with Sutton's heretical Anglican office book. And then this morning, I was studying 2 Peter. And one of the themes and characteristics of St. Peter is to warn the Christians about false teachers. He says, they shall arise among you. They're just going to happen. And
Right.
I date Second Peter as early as 63 AD, maybe 67 AD, in that window, that even in the apostles' time, he's predicting and forewarning the church about coming false teachers. And how do they come in? They come in very quietly and privily. You know, there's snakes in the high grass that you don't see. And they
That's why
bring
you
in
need to have elders in your church that are well trained too, because they can see the snakes.
Absolutely. And that would go back to your preach, catechize, and visit.
Right.
And denying the Lord who bought them. That's not universal atonement. That's saying that the gospel they teach denies that Christ's death was sufficient. So that when they pray in this saint's name or that saint's name, that by the merits of that saint, they may enjoy eternal felicity and justification. That is heresy. And I'm talking about
Absolutely.
Anglican province of America. I'm talking about the Anglican Church of Anglo-Catholic Church, which Calvin Robinson joined. He's joined a church that preaches a damnable heresy. That includes the ACPK. That includes the OAC, Orthodox Anglican Church here in America. That includes a good section of the Anglican Church of North America. Jack,
can I get you to put a pin in this, Donald? It's 11:03 right now. And I got a meeting I got to get to in about 20 minutes.
Okay, well, we were
I'd
going to.
like to come back and deal with 13. If you would, can you send me 13 so I can look over it before next Friday?
We can do that.
Because I think we can make some hay over that. And I do apologize to any of your viewers if I come across as offensive.
That's fine. Let's close in prayer then. Almighty and most sovereign God, we give thanks for Jeremiah, the prophet and warrior. Inspire and provoke in us that same warrior mindset of Jeremiah, that we may go forward, pull down the proud strongholds, to uproot and destroy Pharisaic pride and false doctrines, as Jeremiah was commanded to do. Grant that we may sow thy seed, teach thy word, nurture thy people, and shepherd them, not as overlords and tyrants, but as loving under-shepherds of the flocks of the great shepherd. Grant, we beseech thee, a revival, reformation, and recovery of our great reformed confessions of faith. And may we announce with joy and victory that we are justified by Christ alone, received through faith alone, and that we would rejoice and present the five solas. Grant that we may exalt thy word above all nations, continents, USA, Canada, South America, Central America, South Africa, the Mediterranean countries, Europe, Russia, the Middle East and Far East, to lift up and exalt thy word and thy word above every church organization, everybody who calls himself an archbishop or bishop, elders and others. May we exalt thy word, planting truth and sound doctrine, fidelity and manly courage. May we follow Jeremiah's example as a warrior and fight manfully and skillfully from the city of God. Through the efficacious grace and conquering sovereignty of our indubitable and exclusive mediator and protector, King Jesus, whom with thee and the Holy Ghost we adore and worship as the one true and living God, world without end. Amen.
Amen.
So we're hitting the Normandy beaches as
Amen.
A warm band of brothers. So I'll talk to you before Friday, and I have you on the schedule for next Friday.
But if you would send me that, what you got there, 13, as I was reading through it, I want to delve into that because that's some good stuff.
Okay, will do. So I'll talk to you later, Aaron.
All right, we'll see you later, Donald.
Bye-bye.
Bye.